Victoria's longest-serving Labor Premier, Daniel Andrews, has resigned. He's held the position since 2014, but his decision to walk away has surprised many. He'll finish up at 5pm tomorrow.
It's not an easy decision because as much as we've achieved together, there's so much more to do. But when it's time, it's time.
Labor's caucus will meet at midday tomorrow to decide on his successor. Jacinta Allan is favoured to replace him, but Andrews says he won't be speculating on who'll get the gig. As for his legacy, he says that'll be left for others to decide.
There's an old saying in politics, go when they're asking you to stay. It's really important. It's really important.
At the last election, he promised to serve out his third term in government, but now says he's changed his mind. He says the workload has taken its toll and now plans to spend some quality time with his wife and family.
I am worse than a workaholic. I'd spend every waking moment is about the work, and there's only so long you can do that for. And part of this is I don't know what I'll finish up doing.
And the debate over Dan Andrews' legacy has well and truly begun, hasn't it? He seems to be such a polarising figure. On one hand, you've got the PM saying that he was a builder in education and in health, a man of deep conviction. Then others argue that he left Victoria trashed, its reputation trashed, with a huge record debt. What will his legacy be?
It's going to be one of those that depends who you ask, because the debt stuff, for example, that's going to be a long time before people start going, oh, that's Dan Andrews' fault. But the thing is, his legacy is complicated because of COVID. Like, the whole thing becomes about COVID in the end, doesn't it? And everyone from other states was obsessed with him over COVID.
Yes, totally. Yes. That's all I know about him is the COVID stuff,
and that's
really.
Where a lot of the debt feelings comes from as well. About him pre-COVID are different than post-COVID.
So there was Dan Andrews BC before
COVID.
Well,
I think so, because before COVID, I think, you know, there's this just... I hate it when governments think that they're greater than the people. And before COVID, I don't remember it being like that. Maybe it was, but during COVID and post-COVID, not just in Victoria, but particularly in Victoria, there became a sense that the people were under the boot of the government.
Yeah. But, see, I just don't think that's the way Victorians in bulk saw it.
No, they didn't. And also, I was away for a year of it. I came back to it and I was like, what's going on in this state?
It was fascinating. Sorry, well, I'd be the only one on this panel who lived through COVID as a Victorian. It was really interesting to watch, because you'd watch Sydney people, for example, getting really upset. How can you do this to the Victorians?
On behalf of you guys.
Yeah, and Victorians are sitting there going, that's not how people feel at all. Even though the Herald Sun, for example, was going really hard on it. And I think it was interesting because there were a couple of complicated elements to this. One was the decision to lock down and get to zero was kind of in a way taken out of his hands, because the other states were all putting up their borders if you had a single case or whatever. So it kind of forced Victoria, and I'm not saying it's the only reason he wanted to do this, by the way, but kind of forced Victoria in a situation, well, that's kind of what you have to do, or Victorians are going to be locked in to their own state and never get out. But I think the other element of it is that once you've committed to that and the whole population's going along with that, maybe it's a survival mechanism, maybe people genuinely believe.
Stockholm syndrome?
Well, I don't think it is Stockholm syndrome, actually, but I think there was a thing
but
of like...
But what is it when a government loves ring of steel and you will have a curfew? What is that?
Yeah, but compare that to the attitude in WA. Like, it was... there was not a leader in the country who didn't benefit from putting up a border at that point, right? There just wasn't. That's what happens in Australia. And I think what happened is once there was this sense of Victoria's committing to this role, Victorians ended up going, let's do this, and in a weird way, I think, feeling proud of the achievement. Now, you can look back on that and say, well, that's a weird thing to feel proud of or whatever, and vaccines have completely changed our attitude to COVID and all that sort of stuff. But at the time, especially in that first lockdown, I just think that was the prevailing attitude. So then to see the rest of the country get angry at him for the lockdowns...
But maybe both things are true.
Yeah.
Maybe he did amazing things and amazing infrastructure, but also left an incredible legacy of debt and pushed governmental controls too far.
Yeah, and there's definitely a lot to criticise.
But
that's
all he doesn't just even need to do a transition, apparently. Apparently, being a premier is such a easy job that you can just leave the next day at 5 o'clock. You don't even have to do a handover period.
Yeah, I suspect the success has been pretty
good. I think it was on the cards. Yeah. He didn't just leave. Yeah.